Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this, the 26th meeting in 2015 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome members, welcome our witnesses and welcome any visitors in the gallery? And can I remind everyone please to turn off or at least turn to silent all mobile phones and other electronic devices. Item 1 on the agenda, can I ask if members are content that we take item 6 in private?
Yep,
thank you. And can I ask if members are content to agree that we will review evidence heard at future meetings in connection with the scrutiny of Scotland's budget in private?
Agreed.
That's agreed. Thank you. Item 2 on the agenda, we have a statutory instrument to consider, the Renewables Obligation Scotland Amendment Order 2015. And I'd like to welcome this morning Fergus Ewing, Minister for Business, Energy and Tourism, who's joined today by Fiona Hepplewhite, who is Policy Advisor, Scottish Government, Jason Hubert, Head of Business Development at Forestry Commission Scotland, and Olive Hogg, Solicitor in the Scottish Government. Welcome to you all. Minister, do you want to speak to the instrument, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning to everyone. I had got 3 pages here, which sets out the extraordinary success of the Scottish Government in promoting work through the Renewables Order, but since Convener, I have to be at New Battle Abbey by 10 o'clock to convene the Open Cast Task Force, at which I will submit your apologies. I will just stick to the order, if I may. The order implements policy decisions in relation to the reporting requirements and sustainability criteria for stations using solid biomass and biogas feedstocks to generate electricity. Reporting requirements on the use of solid and gaseous biomass under the RO were first introduced in Scotland in 2009 to ensure that biomass material is sourced responsibly and in a way which minimises and eliminates any adverse impacts. The requirements were enhanced in 2011 and again in 2014. The proposed amendments are designed to ensure that the legislation remains fit for purpose. We see no reason for a divergence from the rest of the UK on biomass sustainability issues, and therefore the amendments mirror those being made to the RO mechanisms in England and Wales and Northern Ireland. This approach, Convener, is favoured by industry. The first of the proposed changes relates to the making compliance with biomass sustainability criteria mandatory in order to receive support. Under the RO Scotland, generators are required to submit information on the sustainability of their biomass fuels to Ofgem. This includes information regarding land use and greenhouse gas emissions. The committee will remember last year they approved an amendment to the RO order which introduced first tighter sustainability standards for electricity generated by solid biomass and second a new requirement for generating stations of 1 megawatt and above to provide an annual independent audit report. These changes were introduced on a reporting only basis to allow generators time to become familiar with what is required in practice. The current amending order would make compliance with the sustainability criteria mandatory. Generating stations of 1 megawatt and above which use solid biomass and biogas will be required to both report and meet the sustainability criteria in order to claim ROCs. The second change relates to greenhouse gas emissions targets. Operators are required to account for the life cycle greenhouse gas emissions for the biomass used to generate electricity. To ensure biomass power delivers genuine greenhouse gas savings, and to promote good practice and innovation across the supply chain, we are introducing a tightening greenhouse gas emissions target. Biomass power is already required to meet a greenhouse gas savings target of at least 60% compared to the EU fossil fuel average, and this target becomes tighter in 2020 and 2025. The tightening greenhouse gas emissions targets will be applied as an annual average to allow generators to better manage procurement risks. This is subject to the provision that a consignment of biomass must not exceed an overall ceiling to ensure each consignment delivers a good level of savings. Finally, we're making a number of technical adjustments to the reporting requirements and sustainability criteria. These minor adjustments and clarifications have been identified as areas which will help ensure the effective operation of the scheme and lead to more accurate reporting by operators. Ofgem will continue to regulate compliance with the mandatory sustainability criteria. To sum up, Convener, these changes will improve the efficiency and sustainability of the RO and ensure that legislation remains fit for purpose. And before I formally move the motion recommending the order, I'd be happy to respond to any questions that members may have.
Okay, thank you, Minister, and I hope you won't break any speed limits on your way to New Battle Abbey. You tried your best to break them, I think, while reading that statement. Do members have any questions they want to put on this instrument to the Minister? No, don't think so. Okay, in that case, Minister, we will move to item 3 on the agenda, and can I invite you, if you would, to move motion S4M14576 that the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee recommends that the Renewables Obligation Scotland Amendment Order 2015 in draft be approved.
Moved.
Thank you. Do any members wish to speak in this debate? Nope. Assuming you don't wish to wind up, Minister, I will then put the question. The question is that motion S4M14576 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Thank you very much. Can I ask the committee are content that the convener and the clerk produce a short factual report of the committee's decisions and arrange to have that published? That is agreed. Thank you. Thank you, Minister, junior officials for coming. Now we'll have a short suspension. Right, if we can reconvene. We are now on item four on the agenda, and as a committee we are now commencing our pre-budget scrutiny in relation to the Scottish Government's budget for 2016-17, which has not yet been published, but because of the parliamentary timetable we are required to start our budget scrutiny work, and we will do that in anticipation of the publication of the budget in a few weeks' time. So I'd like to welcome our first panel. We are joined by Norman Kerr, Energy Action Scotland, Professor David Sigsworth, who has recently stepped down as chair of the Scottish Fuel Poverty Forum, Stuart Wilson of Tyche Innes Gael, will I pronounce that properly, Mr. Wilson? Almost, thank you. And Helen McQuillan, who's from Dundee City Council. So welcome to you all. And the theme for this session is fuel poverty. So I think we're going to run this for about just over an hour, maybe until about 11 o'clock or so. Because there's four of you on the panel, I would ask members if they would direct their questions initially to one panel member rather than just make them open. And if you would like to respond to a question directed to somebody else, if you just catch my eye, and I'll bring you in as best I can as time allows. And if I can ask members to keep their questions short and to the point and answers as short and to the point as possible, that would be very helpful in terms of getting through the topics in the time available to us. Can I maybe just start off and asking a bit about the background to where we are with fuel poverty? Maybe start with Mr. Kerr, put this to you first, and then bring in Professor Sigsworth thereafter. In terms of the trajectory of fuel poverty, we know there are essentially three components in fuel poverty: household incomes, energy prices, and measures to reduce energy consumption. In relation to the first two, household incomes would seem in general to be improving as we're coming out of economic recession. Energy prices, which have gone up substantially in recent years, seem to have plateaued. There's some indication they may in fact be reducing. What is your sense, Mr. Kerr, of the impact these wider economic changes might have on fuel poverty figures, you know, in the coming year?
I think you note that prices have kind of plateaued just now. I think as we look to the future and where we might be bringing our energy from, there's no guarantee that that plateau will remain. And I think the trajectory for fuel prices continues to be one that will increase. How steeply that increases depends, I think, where we bring that energy from in a global market, I've got to stress. That, I think, will have some impact on fuel poverty, undoubtedly. I think we've seen comments around if fuel prices in 2002 had risen at the same state as inflation, fuel poverty would be a lot less. I think that's quite false, because in 2002 we all knew that that was the rock bottom for prices, the prices the energy industry could not sustain, so that was always going to be on an upward trajectory. Prices today, if you go back to the early 80s, before privatisation, prices then, if you put them into an economic recalculation, they're the same prices as today. So the price you pay in the early 80s is the same price you're paying today in real terms. So we've not actually seen a great fall or a great rise in energy prices. They've remained fairly static. But we do know that there are more impacts to come along on fuel price that may well drive prices up, the way in which we have our distribution network, for example, the way in which we will bring new generation on, will all have an impact there. What we are also seeing in terms of, you spoke about an economic growth for the fuel poor, that's not necessarily the case. I think if you listen to people such as the Poverty Alliance or Child Poverty Action, you will get a different story from them. And I know the Scottish Government is promoting very heavily the living wage, but we are still seeing a lot of fuel poor households now actually being in work. It's not people who are living on benefits, it's in work poverty that we're seeing just now. So it's not a great optimism I have for the future in those two particular areas.
Thank you. Professor Sixworth, do you want to add anything to that?
I think three things, really. Norrie's right that fuel prices have plateaued, but the last statistics we have currently published for fuel poverty are the 2013-14 figures for Scotland. And from between 13 and 14, which is outside the range of those figures, average fuel prices, as published by DEC, for the whole of the UK rose about 3%. So we're still actually seeing some increase, and I suspect that, we don't have data right up to date, but I suspect that's still true. And I do stress it's average. And, when you look into what average means, and the fact that, I think at the moment, if you take the average that that's based on, we're talking about a bill of something like 1,340 pounds a year or something like that, the average. And that's for a dual fuel house, three bedroom semi type of thing. If you take that similar type of property in our rural and island areas, that could be £2,000. And that difference makes a very significant to any average that you try to do. And put on top of that our biggest problem in fuel poverty has been that the help and assistance we've had from the widest span of government has been around using Scottish Government's own money, but also eco funds and things like that. They've had to be deployed in a particular way, and that hasn't given us the means of being able to treat the hard to treat properties that are in more remote locations. And part of that fuel issue that you mentioned the three drivers, I think there's a fourth, and I'll come back to that. But of those three issues, if you take fuel price, the actual fuel disadvantage of not being a dual fuel customer, of not having a dual fuel discount, we've seen this last week, Ofgem's report on distribution pricing, where there's some recognition now that that distribution charges in our remoter areas are also much higher. And the fact that if you're on electric heating, you're locked into fuel prices and unit prices that are far higher than we'd see. All of those factors are mitigating towards our worst problem, which is still to find a way of tackling hard to treat properties in more remote locations.
Can I just follow up on that? But I know other members want to come in and talk about rural areas in particular. But I live just outside Perth, so we're not on the gas main. We have oil heating. The cost of my oil heating has come down 50% in the last 2 years. I'm paying half what I was paying 2 years ago. So there must be a beneficial impact on some of the rural households you're talking about, who similarly will be relying on heating oil. They must have seen quite a substantial fall in some of their costs in the same period.
Of course, we don't have figures on that because it's not regulated. And of course, there will be significant differences between what fuel discounts are available in those areas. Although I would say nationally that oil suppliers have tried to do in a concerted way, giving assurance that they are keeping prices in check. But it's not something we can judge and gauge. What I would just like to come back to is that fourth issue. Because in terms of fuel poverty, there is an increasing awareness that the way when we provide measures to eradicate fuel poverty, unless the individual in that home has been shown, and not just shown once, shown and trained to actually get the best out of that, it won't work. And we'll find that the measure is only partially effective, and we've got to tackle that measure too, because that fourth issue of how they live, how they use the system, will come from deeper integration of social care with fuel poverty measures and primary health care.
Okay, perhaps Mr. Wilson could put the question to you around specifically this point about rural communities and the impact of fuel prices on them.
Yes, your issue on oil price is an interesting one. Of course, to impact fuel poverty, it presumes that the oil has been used in the first place, and the household can afford to heat the home in the first place. And what we tend to find is that people will effectively self-disconnect because they just can't afford to fill an oil tank. And of course, there are minimum bulk buy amounts that you have to buy to fill your tank. We find that households simply can't even afford that. And so, whilst the price has come down, and it's similar in our area, this price has come down from maybe about a peak of maybe 75 to 76 pence a litre down to now about 35, 36 pence a litre in the last month or so. So, it's come down significantly. However, the people who are in the most fuel poor, the extreme fuel poor, they would have been self-disconnecting anyway, and they could only use a limited amount of oil in the first place. So it doesn't necessarily have an immediate impact on the number of fuel poor.
Okay, thank you.
Can just go back on one thing about the average price per household. From our survey reasonably recently, the average price on the Western Isles, and similar to stats coming from our colleagues in Skye and Lough Alsh, the average household bill is about £2,300, £2,400 on islands. So it's significantly higher, about £1,000 higher than the average nationally.
Okay. Thank you. Heather McCullen. Yeah.
Just two wee points. Price of fuel, quantity of fuel isn't there. We're coming in a really bad winter if the rowan berries are anything to go by. So there's a fourth factor, the quantity of fuel. And also, just to echo what David said about use of system, my council's involved in large-scale external wall insulation, which in some ways is the holy grail. I mean, it's very, very expensive. But with heaps money from the Scottish Government, we're really going into it wholesale. And you might think that external wall insulation has no moving parts. You're up the building up, and that's the end of the story. But there's even a requirement for advice there, because people think, we say to them, you will save money on your fuel, but they don't realise that you've got to switch your thermostat down or your TRVs. It's not just a case of letting it be. There's lifestyle changes that come with it. So,
okay, thanks for that. Just before I bring in Dennis Robertson, I think wants to pursue some of these issues. I just want to ask one more question, maybe start again, Mr. Kerr, with yourself. We know that the Scottish Government has a target to eradicate fuel poverty as far as reasonably practical by November 2016. So that will fall within this budget period we're looking at. What would you put the chances of that target being met?
Sadly, none. I think we are at a stage where we have... this year's figures are not yet out. They will come out at the end of November. But last year's figures were 940,000 households. We do not treat anything like that per year, so I sadly have to say that the fuel poverty target will not be reached, and by some considerable way. What I can say is that we know that fuel poverty levels would be significantly higher had it not been for Scottish Government putting money in from the public purse into grant programmes. Nonetheless, the fuel poverty target will not be achieved.
Professor Sixworth, do you agree or disagree with that?
I think we've got to remember that the 2016 target was set with a rider that said as far as is reasonably practical. And I think if we look at what has been done over many years within the limitations of the devolved powers, I think, you know, we have made quite a substantial move forward. And in fact, if we look now over the last 5 or 6 years at the improvement that we've seen in the number of EPC B and C rated properties that we have in Scotland, we're doing far better relatively than we're seeing in England at the moment. In percentage terms, I'm not trying to say that's right. I'm just saying that I'm asking myself, given that at the moment the Scottish Government can't actually regulate the fuel price and they're not in control at the moment of household income, as far as what is reasonably practical, some would argue that quite a lot has been achieved. But it doesn't alter the fact that I don't believe, as Noreen has said very publicly, I don't expect us to be anywhere near eradication next year. What I am pleased about, and I said in my recent report that I published, is that I think the national infrastructure priority gives an opportunity looking forward to actually think about uniquely Scottish solutions that do address many of the issues that we've been talking about already.
Just to pick up one point you made, Professor Sigsworth, are you advocating that the Scottish Government should have the right to regulate the fuel price?
I actually would like to. I would like to see Ofgem be having some responsibilities to this Parliament and being accountable for some of their measures in setting the context. Because I know, it's not that I just believe, I know that at the moment we need different solutions to the ones we've been seeing spread more widely in urban and suburban areas across the rest of the UK.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'll bring in Dennis Roberts.
Thank you very much, Convener. Before I sort of move on to the sort of a poverty groups that we have, the Convener brought in, obviously, the target. And it was a point that Mr Kerr made earlier, and it was to do with related to fuel prices and inflation. Is it not the case that if fuel prices had been allied to or in line with inflation, instead of 39% of households being in fuel poverty, we would have probably been about 11%. Now, 11% is still high. But is it not the case that if the prices had been aligned to inflation, that would have been a situation of 11% rather than 39%?
Mr Robertson is entirely correct. Yes, that would have been the case. The point I was making, though, was that the prices in 2002 were artificially low. They could not be maintained at that level. That was at a time where the market was at, you could say, its worst or its best. Energy companies were not in profit. They were actually losing money at that time. It was unsustainable. The fact that we had a regulator who removed price controls, you could argue, may not have helped. The price control mechanism of RPI plus or minus X that the energy companies had to take to the regulator when they wanted to increase. The regulator took that away to encourage more competition. But from 2002, we saw energy companies from 13 offerings down to six. So we had a lot of joining together, but fuel prices did rise and they rose well above inflation. So had it been with inflation, yes, but was that likely? The answer to that is no. That was never going to be the case, and I think it's a false hope that people had that it would be with inflation.
Thank you for clarifying that. My main point is, maybe Mr Wilson can follow up on this. At the moment we've got three fuel poverty action groups. Is that the right way to go in some respects, having three groups, in terms of, is a one size fits all not more appropriate, or having the three groups, and another one is a short-term strategic group, and one looks at specifically remote and rural, is that the best solution we have, to have those three groups and maybe working together? And do they coordinate, for instance, and work together? Because I'm not sure that they do. Or should we have just one size fits all?
So maybe Mr. Wilson, I guess you have to... whichever way you go, they have to communicate with each other. Whether it's one group or whether it's three groups as we have at the moment, I think that whichever structure is in place, it has to recognise that there are differences across the country. And I'm not convinced that simply combining it into one group would be a cure-all for that. Certainly the Rural Task Force has a job to do, and from my participation so far within that, it is seriously picking up some of the key from our perspective, some of the key issues in the rural areas, which hopefully will be then tagged into to a report at the end.
So. Which can help me then. I actually welcome the fact that there is a rural task group looking at this, because I think that in some cases, and I think Professor was sort of mentioned, you know, in terms of when we look at sort of average prices and all the rest of it, when we look at remote and rural, and certainly in Scotland, our prices are much higher. But I think identifying the specific needs of our remote and rural areas is something that we need to do. So how do we actually try and resolve some of the problems for those areas in line with what's happening within the sort of bigger framework, say within central Scotland, and trying to tackle fuel poverty right across the board? Should there be a different scale for say grants and subsidies for remote and rural?
I think it comes down to priorities and what you want to do, how you want to prioritise the limited money that you have, and do you want to tackle the most fuel poor areas first, and how do you prioritise that? And clearly, the most fuel poor areas tend to be as you go further away from the big population centres, and the more rural you become, as well as some concentrated ones within the cities, obviously. So I think there is a thing about how you prioritise funding towards the most fuel poor areas, and to do that, you then have to recognise that what you tend to find in the most fuel poor areas is that the housing stock there and the part of the triangle that you talked about earlier that we do have quite close control over in terms of energy efficiency, it tends to cost more money in the more rural areas, simply because the housing stock is different and it demands a different solution. And again,
the point you made to the convener in terms of people self and attend regulating but disconnecting because they don't have, for instance, the finances to fill an oil tank is quite important, because people are probably dependent on one fuel source, which tends to be electricity in some of those areas because they're not connected to the gas. Does this in itself pose a larger problem for a remote and rural? Are they looking towards maybe looking at alternatives, maybe in terms of solid fuel, and that could be burning anything that they could find?
It's a huge electric prices in the islands particularly are extremely high, and the point that was made earlier regarding tele-switch meters and where clients, householders are effectively locked in, not technically locked in, but it's very difficult to switch when you're on a tele-switch meter. And some of the tariffs, it's quite difficult to do. And
sorry, just to explain for our benefit, what a tele switch meter is.
A dual meter where you have, for instance, SSE, who are the biggest supplier in, obviously in the north of Scotland, have a tariff called Total Heat and Total Control, where that's a 24-hour tariff for heating and hot water, and that 24-hour tariff is on a low rate, but there's a standard rate for everything else in the property. So your cooking, your lighting, your TVs, your hi-fi, all that's on a standard rate. So you've got a dual switch, and the heating element is tele-switched. It's controlled by the power company, in order to help the control of the grid. But for customers to go into that tariff, they have to have that meter. To the SSE are the only ones that offer that tariff effectively. So if you phone up for to try and switch, you won't, or go into the comparison sites, you won't find it. It will be difficult to find. And if you try to switch to somebody else, they'll say, "Sorry, I don't know what that meter is," and we can't switch you. And whilst they might have an obligation to switch you, technically they find it very difficult to do it. So if you're 65, 85 and you're phoning up to try and do that, and somebody says, "I don't think we can do it," you tend just to put the phone down at that point. So it's very difficult to switch across. And what you tend to find within those tariffs are, although it's just recently, literally the other day, the tariff came down and its rate, but the standard rate of that tariff is enormously higher than what you would find on other companies for standard rates. You can find 10 pence a unit on the market at the moment for standard rates, whereas on that THDC tariff, you might be up at 19%, depends per unit for the standard rate.
So have you not had a director of SSE until recently? Do you have anything to say on this issue?
I left SSE in 2005, but these were solutions that were developed certainly while I was working with the company, certainly, but I've had no contact with them on that sort of basis since 2005.
Okay. Mr. Carey wanted to come in. Yeah.
I think we often quote SSE here as the only company across Scotland, both of the main electricity suppliers developed dynamic teleswitch tariffs as a means of flattening their generation curve. So it equally applies in Dumfries and Galloway as it does in Orkney and Shetland.
Right.
It's now at a stage where I think the companies themselves are looking at that as a tariff because it's not serving the purpose that it was intended to when we had vertically integrated companies. And the companies could dump excess energy at some point during the day, should they have it. However, what I would say is, looking to the future, there is an opportunity to adapt or adopt dynamic teleswitching if we're looking where we have a vast number of wind turbines, or we have some tidal power, or as we've seen now, the growth in solar. We will need things to compensate and store energy, and dynamic teleswitch gives us the opportunity to do that. So while it's not serving well just now, that's not to say that with some further investigation, with some further infrastructure by the companies, we don't have something that can actually serve as well as we move forward into the future. So it's a fairly old historical thing, but we do have the opportunity to bring it up. And if you think where we are, National Grid will spend approximately £1 million a day on constraint payments. In other words, telling companies, we don't need your energy just now, please don't generate. Why are we doing that in remote rural communities who are living underneath turbines? Surely we should be finding an innovative solution in which to store that energy. Dynamic teleswitching gives us that opportunity, along with things such as battery storage and others. But just now, I think Mr. Wilson makes a very valid point. It's not the best for many, many customers, and not just in rural Highlands, but along the borders as well.
Are our customers in remote and rural being disadvantaged then? Are they being, in one sense, penalised for not being on, say, the, you know, for mainline gas and stuff like that? So they've got to rely on electricity regardless of how it's generated, and the fact that maybe we don't have a storage facility at the moment. So they're being disadvantaged. Should we be looking at some way to try and mitigate that, Mr. Kerr?
I think there is already some mitigation. There's the hydro replacement scheme that's around, and that does give some compensation. But Ofgem's report last week recognises that the way in which we operate our system in those remote rural areas, the cost to the customer is around £60 a year. Not an insignificant cost, but it's still a cost. And I think Ofgem have stated they've got some sympathy with reopening that investigation to look at whether or not we do have the infrastructure that we need.
Okay. And if we finally convene our...
Professor Sigsworth, want to come in first?
Yeah. I think the root of this question was, did we need three elements to the Fuel Poverty Forum? And I chaired the Fuel Poverty Forum from 2011. And it was very, very difficult to move away from talking about measures and talking about monitoring and talking about, let's say, the ongoing development of those schemes. The problem I've seen has frustrated me for some time is that measures will not solve fuel poverty completely. I mean, we have homes which are B and C rated in Scotland now where people are still living in fuel poverty. And the solution that's required has to look more widely. And over the summer, myself, Norrie was involved, but some other members of the forum spent quite a bit of time mapping all the connections that we could see, direct and indirect connections, to the fuel poverty issue. And those maps are very complex, and to make real sense of them, they need more work. What they showed is that many, many parts of government, NGOs and others had to collaborate and cooperate, and they had to join up in a way that's not happening completely at the moment. And I've provided those maps to government, and they're just part of looking forward and making sure that what comes forward is a different sort of structure, but also a different weight of solution, because in those rural areas, if we look at biomass, if we look at a lot of renewable solutions that can be under the community's own control and can even be maintained in a local economy where we've upskilled the local economy to be able to have the skills to install and maintain their systems. This actually leads to a completely different picture. And that's the sort of thing, this third element that certainly I've just been asked to chair as a short life working group, will not be looking at the ongoing, that will still be the preserve of the Fuel Poverty Forum, but trying to bring together independently with a different group of experts that long-term picture and putting it to the government. That's where I think the difference can be made.
That was extremely helpful. Well, Professor Zagwarthan, you actually anticipated my question, which was even more helpful. So, convener, I think that's probably...
Okay, thank you. I've got a couple of members who want to come in with supplementaries before we move on. Lewis MacDonald and then Joan McAlpin, and then we'll need to move on, I think.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I was struck by the reference to total heating, total control and tele-switched systems. The witnesses will be aware of the Competition and Markets Authority investigation into the energy market, and when the CMA appeared before this committee, they undertook that they would look at that issue as one of the issues that merited investigation. Are there other areas where witnesses believe competition issues arise and are a cause of fuel poverty, where people are not able to access a proper choice and that is part of the reason for them finding themselves in fuel poverty?
I think we saw Ofgem some time ago take action to reduce the number of tariffs that were around, and they asked companies to pull that back to four main tariffs. We believe that that's not necessarily been the right way. We believe it stifles innovation, and I think Ofgem are now looking at widening that out again. Professor Sigsworth talked about renewable energies. There is no dedicated tariff for renewable energy just now. If you have a air source heat pump or a ground source heat pump, there is no dedicated tariff for that. And if we want to expand that type of measure, then we need to look to the energy industry to come forward with tariffs. So there is a bit of competition that's not working well there, because the regulator has stepped in. Companies do have the opportunity to go to the regulator to ask for a derogation, to say, we've got something new we want to try. And I think the number of derogations that Ofgem have given have led them to believe that they need to carry out that investigation a bit more. I think, as we've heard, the dynamic teleswitch is one that I think a number of suppliers would like to get into, and I think between the two, they're probably the biggest barrier. In some ways, in Scotland, it's about brand loyalty. Many people in the north of Scotland remember the Hydro Board. They have a lot of relatives who work for the Hydro Board. They're a major employer in that area, and I suppose if you were getting someone to switch supplier, my question would be, are you getting them to switch supplier for the sake of switching, or are you getting them to switch for a better deal? And the reason I say that is we're currently in the Big Energy Saving Week, where people have been encouraged to look to change supplier. However, if you're on the wrong payment method for you and you move to a different supplier, still on the wrong payment method, then you're no better off. If you're on the wrong tariff for you and you move to a different supplier, still on the wrong tariff, you're no better off. And I think the point that's been made, and Heather McQuillan made it earlier, about education, is one that we need to take much more seriously, so that when people are making a comparison, then they actually understand what they're doing and they can do that. And indeed, Ofgem have worked with some of the switching sites, because again, the switching sites until recently were unregulated, and it's been useful to have more guidance to them, because a lot of them will go on, if you want to switch supplier today, not necessarily I want to switch supplier in a month's time. So there's a restricted number of tariffs that switching sites will show you when you go on, and there will also be some that they don't show you because they don't have a deal with a particular energy company. So I think organisations like Citizens Advice perhaps in the future have a role to provide a more wider detailed provision of what tariffs and payment methods are available for all members of the public. So in terms of competition, I think we've got more of an education to do before we can say that people will buy into competition for their benefit, not just for the sake of it.
Thank you. Professor Sixworth.
I agree with everything Norris just said. I'd just like to go on a bit further into different solutions, because what Norris was talking about there was what I would call relatively conventional solutions. We know now that there's a huge enthusiasm in communities in Scotland for owning and operating their own energy assets and systems. And the Scottish Government put £20 million up not too long ago for the first phase of a challenge fund for community energy. And as I understand it, I may have these statistics wrong, I'm just dredging them up from the back of my mind. I think there were 140 applications for that first. So that's the level of enthusiasm for community energy. And a goodly portion of those couldn't be actually taken forward for consideration because the regulatory frameworks required for them to work, either because of licensing or one thing or another, didn't enable them. And so many of them dropped out. And I think we've talked about Ofgem already. Ofgem are considering unconventional models of regulation as these markets develop. But we in Scotland have got some of the most fertile opportunities for that. And I think we've got to push on that front as well, because a lot of these renewable schemes, and particularly community ownership and operation of them, will need further enabling from Ofgem. And that's why I was saying we ought to be holding them to account here too.
Well, briefly, because we are getting behind the clock.
Briefly, yeah. Just to ask if either China and Chingal or indeed the Fuel Poverty Forum will make a submission to the Competition and Markets Authority inquiry on tele-switch meters and other matters.
Yes, absolutely. Just
to go a bit further back in the earlier conversation, my supplementary concern, you talked about the three elements. Obviously, household income was one of those elements. And I also sit on the Welfare Reform Committee, and we commissioned some research from Sheffield Hallam University earlier this year that showed that the impact of welfare reforms to date in Scotland was about £350 million for tax credits, and some families had already lost about £1,800. Surely that must be having an effect on fuel poverty as well.
Of course it is. I mean, our energy advisors, added to their role, is delivering Tesco vouchers. So they're getting dragged into stuff that's not just fuel poverty, it's food poverty as well. I can't really say anymore.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely, it's the case. And particularly in the islands, the Western Isles has one of the lowest average incomes in Scotland. I think we're second or third lowest in Scotland. So clearly, when you begin to take a few hundred pounds out of a potentially a monthly wage, then or income, then that can have serious effects. And the immediate effect of that usually is people will ration their energy at that point, and they won't heat to the standards that if you go in and do an EPC and it says that's a, even if it's a B rated home, it might be an efficient home, but they can't heat it. They can't afford the heat. So while it appears as reasonably good, it's not effective because the income side of the triangle prevents them from actually heating their home. So it has a direct knock-on effect, obviously, on the number of people who and we see it when we work with some of the utilities around debt relief and the types of customers who go into debt and then get caught in that spiral, and it's difficult to get them back out again.
Okay, I think we need to move on because we're getting behind the clock, and I want to move on to talking about the budget and bring in Jake Brody.
Yes, I'd like to come to the budget. Just as an input to that, though, before I do ask the question, can I ask Heather McCullen a question about in looking at the in Dundee, the allocation of funding from HEAP's ABS to private sector and then the council's capital budget. I mean, is it realistic that you're applying, and not just Dundee, the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation? I mean, for example, improving houses in Graham Street as opposed to Whitfield or Fintry or Curtin. I mean, how do you, is it realistic?
Use SIMD to...
Yeah. I mean, are you using that?
We use it as a proxy for fuel poverty because, I mean, fuel poverty is notoriously difficult to measure, to track. It's so dynamic and it's so costly to say this household is fuel poor by the definition. I mean, as soon as you open the door, you know they're fuel poor. But in the absence of anything easier, I mean, what we want is a quick way of identifying the worst and get stuck right in there to do something for those affected.
But I think we want to also avoid divisions and complaints of relativities as to who's getting funding from where, which is relevant to the question I'm about to ask in terms of all of the witnesses, if I may. What would you like to see in the forthcoming Scottish budget to affect fuel poverty? And I know you're just going to say more money, but is there anything else that you consider?
Answered my question. I think this committee, some years ago, I had the pleasure of being here and was asked about the level of funding that was needed. And at that time, I said Energy Action Scotland had calculated from 2006 until 2016, we needed £200 million a year. This committee took up that recommendation and indeed included it in their own recommendation. We've not seen that level of funding achieved over that period of time. I think what we do need to do is have continued funding, and it may well be that budget, as you will have seen, has risen over the years. We've gone from about 65 million, and that's bumped along for a couple of years. It's now 119 million that the Scottish Government is putting in. I would expect them to at least maintain that, but I would be hoping that they would, at that time, undertake their own research to discover how much money is needed to achieve the eradication of fuel poverty. Now, that might be to bring every house in Scotland up to a certain EPC banding, and indeed over the last year, Energy Action Scotland, along with some others, was part of a Scottish Government working group on the regulation of energy efficiency in the private sector, REAPs, as it went under the heading. And there was a great deal of work undertaken there by that group to look at the amount of money that was needed. And I think the figure we came up with was an average, and to stress, an average of £2,500 per household to bring it up to somewhere in the region of a band D. It's not a huge step up from where we are, but nonetheless, it's an important step up. So I think the question in the budget is not how much is in the budget for this year, although, as I say, my expectation would be that it's a minimum of it is just now, but what do we do with the budget moving forward on a national infrastructure priority, and can we actually set budgets over a 5 or a 10 year period that commits future parliaments into that national infrastructure? Because that's what we need to look at. If we're talking about big infrastructure programmes, for example, the new Forth Crossing, that's over a longer period of time. I think we need to ask ourselves, where do we want to be, and how much do we realistically need to get on the table? Energy Action Scotland is not saying the Scottish Government needs to fund all of that. I think the Cabinet Secretary has spoken before that he's quite interested in things like equity release, to allow people to use some of the equity tied up in their property to make home improvements where they can. So it's not all about just asking the Scottish Government for funding, it's about trying to identify innovative ways of funding. I think what we do need to recognise is that the budget, whatever the Scottish Government put forward, their aspiration around having that matched by the energy company obligation will not come to fruition.
Sorry to interrupt, Norman, but this relates to what I've just asked Heather. And we know it's going to be tough. The question is, are we targeting the spending that we have? Are we really targeting ECO and HEAPS as best we can to ensure we get the biggest bang for our buck?
Yes and no. Because I would say ECO is not targeting. ECO is targeting where it can get the biggest bang for its buck in carbon saving. And that's about replacing a boiler in the central belt of Scotland. It's not about addressing the issues that Mr Wilson highlighted in the Western Isles, where the carbon saving will be an awful lot less, but the saving in warmth and the increase in energy efficiency will be very high. So ECO doesn't do that. But what the Scottish Government HEAPS ABS programme did was say to local authorities, we expect you to come up with a fuel poverty plan. And by and large, local authorities have undertaken that. You use the question of index multiple deprivation. That works in some areas. It doesn't work in rural areas. And one of the reasons it doesn't work in rural areas, because the SIMD talks about access to a vehicle. And if you have access to a vehicle, then that goes against you. You've got to say, in rural areas, if you don't have access to a vehicle, you are very isolated and stranded. So a lot of people will have access to a vehicle in a rural area, and that skews the index multiple deprivation. So, you know, just because rural local authorities may not use that as their only guide, doesn't mean to say that they're not targeting fuel poverty. And a number of them have done very good local mapping exercises using a whole lot of local data, SIMD for one, the council tax banding for another, levels of housing benefit. So there's a whole range of things that local authorities have been doing to overlay that, and they are starting to target those areas. The point I make is, though, we're doing that now. We should have been doing this 10 years ago.
Okay, one last question, if I may.
Well, I think it's very important maybe to get the other members of the panel to answer the key question, really, which is, what would you like to see in the Scottish Government's budget? And if you can be fairly brief, that would help. Mr Wilson, do you want to start?
You talk about how do you prioritise when you spend. If the difficulty with HEAPS, the HEAPS programme has been, and it's been a good programme, don't get me wrong, it's been a good programme, but the difficulty is it's been coupled to ECO. And because it's coupled to ECO and the leverage, you're trying to get a certain leverage of ECO in through HEAPS, which is in a sense is a kind of sensible thing to do. But what that ties you to then is where the energy companies will spend their money in ECO. And they want the biggest bang for their buck, basically, and they will go where it's cheapest. And so they will not tend to gravitate out to the rural areas because it's dearer to do things and it costs more, and it's harder to get measures to work within the eco programmes. And so they tend to not spend their money out in the rural areas. So that makes it difficult to operate their HEAPS programme in the rural areas. So I would say one of the things, if we're looking at in a budget kind of policy term, is decouple ECO from HEAPS. And not to say don't use it, but decouple it. And don't make that a kind of priority in terms of trying to get big carbon savings off the back of that. It's fuel poverty we're talking about, and not necessarily carbon. SIMD doesn't work in the rural areas. It's just not a good proxy in the rural areas because of the domains within SIMD, as Norrie has mentioned, and the indicators within those domains, it doesn't pick up fuel poor because of the dispersed nature of geographies and households and villages in the rural areas. It just doesn't work well at all. And for that reason, one of the big schemes that predated ECO, called CESP, principally around fuel poor communities, was meant to target them. Lots of the ones in the islands, Scottish islands, just never came in under the radar. They weren't eligible because the SIMD was the driving factor for that. So they were excluded from those schemes altogether. So you have to be very careful about how you use SIMD. SIMD is a good measure for what it's meant to do, but if you use it as a proxy for fuel poor, in the rural areas, it doesn't work very well, and we need to do something else. In the Western Isles, we're trying to work with the NHS, who have very good local kind of sets of data around ill health, and we're trying to couple that together with the fuel poor, because clearly health and fuel poverty, cold, damp homes, tends to generate conditions, and we're trying to couple that together and get the data sets working together. You then get issues around data protection, which you have to try and overcome, but that's the aim at the moment, to try and do that. The other thing was one that Professor Sigworth mentioned about that fourth element that we've continually missed, and it's about in-house advisors from trusted local networks. And one of the things we've been talked about in the Fuel Poverty Task Force was, again, about, it came out very strongly at the last meeting, local networks trying to deliver in-house advice off the back of whatever programmes we put in place, and take a chunk of the HEAPS programme and point it to that. So that's another possibility.
Could I just really, really want to endorse that point. You cannot underestimate the use of advice services and the multiplier of effect they have. I mean, in Dundee over 3 years, we've got £4 million worth of warm homes discount, where eligible households get a saving of £140 on their electricity a year. And they've been able to do that because they've got out there into the houses. You know, for every pound spent on advice, you could say 20, 30, 40 is the effect of that. So it's an effective use of money.
Can I just one last question? Last week I met an international investor from Ireland. They've been investing a lot in energy efficiency. And now Professor Sidgwick mentioned your community development and renewables, which we support, so at least equity shared by communities. But one of the things they're doing in Ireland is training young people in their communities to insulate, you know, do roof insulation, things like that. I mean, if there were an element like that in the budget, I mean, would you support that? Do you believe that communities are capable of doing it? Mr. Kerr says no.
I think that's been a central strand of the propositions that the Fuel Poverty Forum have been developing for well over 2 years now. Our interim report that we put forward, I think in 2012, started that. And I personally have been involved through green growth panels with the government to see whether that could be enabled through Skills Scotland and that sort of thing. I think it's an absolute critical element in getting the best out of this for communities and for further economic development within communities themselves. And if I could just say one thing more about the budget, I think I think everybody's reinforced this, that we've got to make sure that whilst I am a huge proponent of good climate change practice, one of the obstacles we've seen is that carbon has been the surrogate to fuel poverty eradication. So the assumption was, if you make a home energy efficient, you solve fuel poverty. I think one of the things I hope comes out of this session is that's not the case. You go probably a long way towards it, but there's lots more to do as well. And we do need, within the budget, a recognition of some of these things that are the things that we'll have to add to better management of energy efficiency to actually resolve fuel poverty. So not a surrogate, we want a direct, focused fuel poverty reduction component. And that, by the way, is what the Environment Minister promised in making the announcement about the infrastructure priority in June.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm conscious of time. I've got a long list of members still to come in, so I think if we can try and sharpen up a little bit on responses, which are very interesting, but if we can try and tighten up a little bit, otherwise we're going to be here till lunchtime, and we do have a witness session after this. Richard Lyle. Yeah.
And I've got a couple of questions and possibly a comment, but I'll try and be brief. Helen McCann and Norman Kerr actually touched on the points I was going to raise. We've got £119 million in the budget for insulation, all the different things, all the good work that's done in Dundee and all the other councils that are doing cladding and roof insulation, etc., etc. But you touched on the very point that I'm going to ask you. Have any data on after we've done the insulation to houses that their bills actually have reduced? Because physical problem is a lot of people, elderly or people who don't know how to turn down a thermostat. Some of these actual, if you go into your house and you look at some of them, they can be actually quite complicated for the elderly. So do we have people who are going round continually or showing people how to reduce their home, and do we have any data to show that the millions of pounds that were spent in insulation is working because their actual physical bill has went down?
Well, I'll answer that. I get asked that question all the time, and I'm very reluctant to be drawn into, they're saving £150, £180, because as soon as you say that, somebody will say, you promised me that and it didn't happen. So it does vary from house to house. But we do have advisers who go around, not as many as we'd wish. It's a scrabble every year for their ongoing funding. I know we've got Home Energy Scotland, but we've got an in-house team that has been described by senior council officials as a jewel in the council's crown. I mean, it's worth its weight in gold. So they do go around, but they're stretched. There is a requirement for some proper research into this, and I understand that, is it South Ayrshire? They have just commissioned a PhD student to do research into this very subject. I think it's a joint project with the local health board, just to pin down what exactly should people be told, what are the potential savings, what are the savings at the moment. So it's an area that it's easy to say, yeah, we'll do this to your house and you're going to save a fortune, but the follow-up advice and putting a number on the potential savings and real savings is a lot harder, and it does require that level of academic research.
To be even briefer for the convener and Norman, I'd like to come on to the point you made. Right, so we've spent all this money on outside cladding, wall insulation, roof insulation, millions and millions of pounds. Is it working? And should we be looking at, as a point I've made on several occasions, we're building new homes, we should be looking to put on solar roof panels in order to generate some sort of energy back into the house. Should we be looking at solar panels, you touched on it earlier, in order to ensure that what we're doing, whilst it might be working, but I believe we could actually do more, which would touch on the point that Professor David Sigwards was going on about individual areas looking at, helping themselves. Should we be looking at doing more in solar panels in order to generate back into the house?
Yes, I think is the answer. We continue to bring forward amendments to the building regulations every year. Indeed, one of your parliamentary colleagues, Sarah Boyack, tried to have a bit into the building regulations that said a building should bring forward 25% of its energy demand from renewable sources. Sadly, I don't think that made that to the statute books for whatever reason, but that would have achieved just exactly what you're saying. The difficulty that we have, Mr. Lyle, is that 80% of the buildings that we have today, we will still have in 2050. So it's about a retrofit to that, not necessarily because changes to the building standards won't impact on that retrofit, but we need to do some more. And the savings do work, but to come back to the point that Joan McAlpine made, in many cases we're improving the energy efficiency of people's homes. They themselves won't save money. There's a rebound effect here. What it means is they can actually heat their home to the standard that they need to heat it just now. So they're not saving money, but they're actually able to heat their home. And that's got a lot of benefits in terms of health and other things that, you know, as Heather says, we're already trying to estimate that. We're trying to understand that a bit better.
Mr. Wilson, you want to come in?
Can I just come back on that one point? We did a report for our local authority just last year or earlier this year on the cost benefits of running the HEAPS programme and looked at the individual measures, and because we've run it for a couple of years now and looking at cost benefits off the back of actual customers and actual bills. For the kind of relatively low cost measures, they've got a very quick payback in terms of investment, in terms of financial payback. So 5-6 years for some of the measures. The hard to treat measures, external wall insulation, has got a longer payback, but it's within the payback is just within the life of the asset for the terms of eco give life of assets for each of those measures. The simple measures, lofts, cavity wall insulation, draft proofing, they all pay back very, very quickly. The hard to treat measures pay back, but it takes a bit longer. But it comes back to that point, you're not just saving the energy bills, you're making people's lives completely different, transforming their lives, where they don't just all huddle in one room, literally. The kids can go to the bedroom and study. It's things like that that you have to take into consideration as well, besides the actual financial benefit.
Can I just also make one comment? Do you understand your electricity bill or your gas bill? You turn it over and you look and you go, it's like double Dutch, therms, kilowatts, whatever. You know, the you were on about the factor of energy companies giving us better prices. Could you not give us a bill that we could all understand? We all know what the price is on the front, but on the back we've got this double Dutch that nobody understands. And if we could all get a simpler form, I could say, well, if I switch to X company, I will save £100 a year or whatever.
We've got some way to make bills simpler. You're right. I spent 3 hours one evening trying to explain to my father-in-law how to change cubic metres or cubic feet into cubic metres and then multiply that by the calorific value. It was a painful conversation. But yes, we have made those bills easier. We're now getting graphs on the bills. We're doing a lot more there. It would be nice if we went to a system where, as you drive along the high street, you see a petrol station, pence per litre, then we should be able to have that on the bills. And I think that will come, because energy companies are trying to provide much clearer billing than we had 5-10 years ago. Moving in the right direction, but still more to do.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. The question of money, I would like to press you on a bit further. We've touched on it a bit, but this is budget scrutiny. David mentioned the National Infrastructure Priority and reminded us that that was designated formally in June. But a year ago, when this committee was doing budget scrutiny, that's when John Swinney agreed that it was going to happen. So a year on, we really should be at a point of knowing what is going to happen under that designation and how much it's going to cost. Yesterday, the climate change minister didn't seem to have any information about this when she was asked about it in the chamber on the emission targets statement, and seemed to imply that they were going to spend another 2 years designing it. Have any of you been brought into discussions within government to talk about what that national infrastructure priority is going to involve, what work will happen under it in the coming year, and how much it's going to cost?
No.
Not at all?
Not at all.
Do you know anyone who has?
I believe there are some tentative discussions. Civil servants are going out just now, but I think the point that you make, it will take some 2 years to design, seems some way in the distance.
Very long way in the distance. Can I? Yeah, of course.
Because I think the group that I've been asked to chair, a short life working group, is specifically focused on that. In fact, we're just in the. It has taken a few weeks to actually get to the point where we can appoint the people. Energy Action Scotland has been commissioned now to be the coordinator of the administration, and all that's happening this week. So I'm hoping that we get the group up and running by late November. But the objective is that over the next year, and I hope well before that year's out, we are going to be looking at how we see an energy efficiency scheme within that long-term infrastructure priority, delivering the eradication of fuel poverty. Now, you know, we've talked about budgets, and interestingly, the 200 million, and I have to give credit for that number largely to Norrie and his team, because if we go back, I think the first time it was mentioned was from some Energy Action Scotland work some time ago, but it was focused specifically on eradicating the worst cases of fuel poverty. It wasn't, the idea was never that 200 million a year would do the whole job. And I think that what we have to do is make sure that we do have that focus within this energy efficiency priority that isn't a surrogate through energy efficiency for fuel poverty eradication. It's specific.
That point, and your earlier one, that the same approaches are not necessarily right in terms of a climate change agenda and a fuel poverty agenda, both of which are priorities, legally committed priorities.
I will be responsible with my group for bringing an independent view to government of how this might happen in that infrastructure priority.
Can I just ask the panel's comments on one figure then? You know, 200 odd million was what we were talking about a couple of years back, and I think there was a recognition that the longer you leave it, the bigger the job gets to get to. The National Infrastructure Priority talks about going beyond just domestic buildings and talks about all buildings, and so we're obviously talking about a bigger number. But the existing Homes Alliance, of which Energy Action Scotland is a part, in May put out a briefing saying that their estimate was a total of 4.5 billion over 10 years, so 450 million per annum, and also talked about matching that with private investment. Is that a figure that the panel think still stands? Is that a reasonable estimate? And should we be judging the level of priority that the government is attaching to this issue by some sort of gauge against that figure?
That work is based, yes, you're right, is from the existing Homes Alliance, but it's work that has been undertaken over a number of years, led by WWF. And I think that figure is very much a baseline from where we want to work to. So, yes, over a 10-year period, we would see that as a reasonable figure. But again, I think the non-domestic sector is one where it may bring in more. It depends how far we want to go there and in terms of raising their levels of energy efficiency. What we don't have is, we've got a figure there, but what we don't have is the government's direction of travel. So we might be basing that on all homes being a D, but actually if we're to address climate change and energy efficiency, all homes might need to be a B, in which case that figure would need to be re-examined. So it's based on what we believe we can get to. But in terms of climate change, we may need to set our sights much higher than that.
And just in terms of the income aspect of fuel poverty, would you be looking to see any specific measures in the coming budget that will look to mitigate the impact of welfare reform on people living in fuel poverty?
Yes, I mean, I think we've already seen some money towards that to support the bedroom tax, etc. And I would like to see that continue. One of the things that we would like to see, the headline and the £119 million, there's about £9 million of that goes to Home Energy Scotland. What we don't see is funding for the things that Heather McCullen and Stuart Wilson were talking about, the local networks that are doing the handholding and moving into people's homes. And it would be exceptionally helpful to recognise the impact that they have and money set aside in the budget, not only to support Home Energy Scotland, which does a magnificent job, but also to support the local groups who are driving that in a much more focused way locally.
Could I just say that whilst it won't be this year, and I fully accept that, I think we've got to look past this year's budget to the expectations of the Smith Commission proposals, because I will certainly, my group, be looking at how we might best deploy the resources that may be vested in Scotland to tackle this job, which there's a substantial amount of money that we may wish to consider spending differently.
Yeah, if I can just quickly respond on one of the points Norrie makes. I mean, I think the thing about local trusted intermediaries and showing that they have been effective is that there are umpteen bits of evidence out there to show that that works really well. And one of the pieces of the jigsaw that isn't there at the moment is that now, Home Energy Scotland has got that on a very limited basis for very specific roles, but it's not the roles we've been talking about this morning, really. So the point that Norrie makes about on the ground infrastructure that's already there and works, but struggles to, as Heather says, to get the funding. If even a small amount of budget was set aside for that, it would make a huge difference to, again, to people, how people operate their own homes. In addition to that, the other part about looking beyond the 1 year budget, as an advisor as well as installers in the local supply chain, the local supply chains hate spikes. They like continuity of delivery, and if you're looking at 1 year budgets, you tend to go boom, 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 and it makes it very difficult to for that local supply chain, particularly in the rural areas, where there'll be an exodus out of the supply chain when you hit that trough in the profile. So you have to try and get a smoother profile for the funding programmes when they get put out there, rather than having the 1 year budget, try and aim for the 3 year, 5 year budget process, because that's how you improve the industry and build up capacity in those local areas. Mm.
Okay, thank you all.
Okay, thank you. Elizabeth.
Yes, thanks very much. When Fergus Ewing gave evidence to this committee on energy, and on our inquiry into energy, he indicated the Scottish Government was positive towards district heating. And I'd just like the views of witnesses in relation to this forthcoming budget. Should we see something to give substance to that commitment? What difference would it make to fuel poverty? Can it tackle fuel poverty and climate change simultaneously, particularly in urban Scotland? I'd be interested in the views of witnesses on district heating and what might be done in that area.
Okay, we've got, as a means of achieving SHQS, Scottish Housing Quality Standard for our stock, our multi-stories presented something of a dilemma. And because of the availability at the time of CESP funding that Stuart mentioned, we were able to install district heating at 10 of the 11 multis. The 11th didn't fall into one of the lowest areas in the SIMD. So that's why that one's missed out. Ours is simple. It's gas-fired district heating, no element of CHP or renewables. Tenants love it. The fuel bills have been slashed. We have some technical difficulties that we've inherited from the install, which are ours to fix. But in general terms, I would say yes to district heating. But as far as Dundee District Council Housing Department is concerned, we've gone as far as we can go. And I now sit on corporate groups where we're trying to create networks in the city which would make our domestic schemes more efficient. I understand that there's been something's gone out to planning departments recently, and we now find planners coming along to these meetings, and I think they would maybe be the key to getting things done locally. The other thing is, I think heaps will over time transmogrify into seeps, which will cover not just domestic but non-domestic, and they'll be brought together. And it's my understanding, although I don't think this is cast in stone yet, that part of the bidding process for heaps next year will be looking for innovative pilots that start looking at that kind of integration of domestic and non-domestic schemes.
I think it needs to be a separate budget headline. I don't think it can be put in with existing budget headlines. They are big projects. Lewis will be aware from, you know, living in Aberdeen, of the Aberdeen Heat and Power Company that I've mentioned before to this committee. That was a big, big cost. And to drop that into a HEAPS budget of 119 million, you know, that would be two combined heat and power district heating schemes. We're talking really big costs here. So yes, it needs to have a separate budget headline. I think for many urban areas where we're trying to address that big cluster of homes, Dundee's done it, Falkirk's done it, Aberdeen's done it, but the examples are fairly few and far between, and we need to have more resources put into there. I know Edinburgh, we're in discussion with Edinburgh University on a new housing development to expand Edinburgh University's district heating scheme into the new housing, and my understanding is that didn't happen, and I'm not sure whether that was down to resource or just the timing of it, but I think we need to, you know, have a real look at that type of project when it doesn't happen. There are too many examples of failed, WIC, for example, too many examples of failed, not enough examples of very good practice, and we need to do a lot more to do it. We need a separate budget headline, not as part of what we're trying to do just now.
I think there's the technology aspect here as well, because if we look at district heating, if we look at things which require some sort of pump priming or some sort of initial subsidy, I mean, the instability that we've seen with renewable heats, incentive, with feed-in tariffs, those have destabilised the opportunity at the moment for many public and private sector groups to come together and actually make some of this work. And I think, again, this is another aspect we've got to grab hold of and try to come up with what we need, because in our rural communities, as well as for the urban environments, we've got lots of new opportunities we're seeing. I mean, just the other week, the government was publicising water source heat pumps, which again as a source of district heating, all of which, if we can actually stabilise the incentives and the programmes and people have confidence in them, then we'll get the investment.
Okay, I've got three members still to come in. We are behind the clock, but I think if unless you all need to rush away, we can run on for a few minutes more. John McAlpin.
Just very quickly to go back to priorities, and the figures that we have been given showed the rise in fuel poverty between 2012 and 2013, and the largest numerical increase was 34,000 amongst owned properties, owner-occupied properties. Now, obviously, you talked about earlier about dealing with the most extreme cases. I wondered what you thought about that in terms of how we prioritise money. I mean, if that's the fastest rising, and I've had discussions with WWF on that there is a problem with owner-occupied properties, but on the other hand, are they the ones that are experiencing the most extreme levels of fuel poverty? I mean, do you think we're prioritising them enough? Should we be prioritising them more or less?
Figures are slightly different in Dundee. I mean, I know you're saying owner-occupied sector is on the rise. In Dundee, it's 49% of the fuel-poor houses, 33% of owner-occupied are fuel-poor, 49% of social, and 51% in the private rented sector. Availability of funding, I mean, HEAPS is specifically for owner-occupiers. In Dundee, we've taken a specific tack on it that owners of ex-council houses are amongst the poorest. We would never be able to insulate blocks of flats, our own flats, because of mixed tenure. So we've used heaps to, which isn't really asking your question, answering your question directly, but yeah, I'll just leave it there.
Yeah, on the Western Isles, we've the fuel poverty levels are so high that they're virtually the same between the owner-occupier stock and the housing association stock. And the reasons for that are the housing association stock is probably better in terms of energy efficiency, but they've got lower incomes. So and whilst the owner-occupier stock will be poorer in energy efficiency, but slightly better in incomes, and it has a balancing effect. So you tend to find that the fuel poverty levels are just very similar across the board. But by far, the biggest portion of the stock is owner-occupier, and it's all croft houses, generally, or that type of housing, so detached dwellings in a kind of crofted setting. So rather than having rows of terraces, we just don't have that type of stock, really. It tends to be an equal measure, both in owner-occupier and fuel poor. And we tend to be prioritising them. Our issue is we've got extreme fuel poor at the same levels as the Scottish average for fuel poor. It's just a different degree, I guess, when you go out to the islands.
Does anyone else want to say anything on that?
Not much to add. I think we do recognise that money since 2001, the very first Scottish Government programme, the Central Heating Programme, has been directed at the private sector and the private rented sector. We've put a lot of money there. I think Energy Action Scotland's view now is that we do need to move not from just giving grants, but also to try and enforce some regulation around the private and private rented sector, so that we can not just have that as an open drain where we're pouring money in, but we actually then start to increase the levels of energy efficiency in that sector and actually make people responsible for that. One of the difficulties in the very early programmes was we gave people a central heating boiler, 10 years later we were going back to give them another boiler and another boiler, but we weren't passing on the responsibility. And I think we need to be saying now, particularly in the private rented sector, if you want to rent a house, if you want to put a house on the market for rent, then there's got to be some level of standard. We enforce that in social landlords to local authorities and housing associations. Why should a private landlord be any different? Why should you be renting a house that's substandard in terms of its energy efficiency from a landlord? So I think that the time's come, we've put a lot of money into that sector, but the time has certainly come where we need to consider very carefully legislation around that.
Okay, thanks very much, that's very useful. Just got one other question on a different subject, which was Professor Sigworth mentioned, was the Smith Commission. I'm not on the Devolution and Further Powers Committee, so I'm just sort of like reading our briefing on the Smith Commission proposals on supplier obligations in relation to energy efficiency and fuel poverty. It seems to me, I mean, for the average person in the street, very confusing about what it actually does. Professor, you were suggesting it's going to make a big difference. Have any of the rest of the panel had any thoughts on these measures in the Smith, proposed by the Smith Commission, and whether they will make a big difference to what you're trying to do?
Eco's horrible. it's horrible. It's the most horrible administrative heavy system I've ever seen, and for people like us at the delivery end, trying to negotiate contracts with the utilities, it's just horrible. We've gone from a position where we had 10 installers out doing things in people's homes to having 2 installers and just about having about 6 administrators now. It's crackers. The opportunity there is if you get control of how eco gets delivered, is you can improve that vastly, because the administration behind it is nuts at the moment, where you're spending probably 3 times as much on administration as you are on the measure for simple measures. it's just daft. And we just don't need to do that. And I think if the Smith Commission can obtain some of those powers to slightly change that, how that will work when it's a UK statutory instrument just now, and how that will get broken down, and how the utilities then respond to that if you get different variations within the delivery, I won't hold my breath there. All I can say is it probably becoming even harder. But
note that in the Scotland Bill, clauses 50 and 51 confirm that powers over ECO implementation will be devolved, but that Scottish ministers must first obtain consent to exercise these powers from the UK Secretary of State. Is that a concern?
Yes, because at the moment, how the portion of the money that comes from ECO to Scotland, UK ECO-wide portion to Scotland, Scotland does reasonably better than maybe we had initially thought. So it comes down to the Scottish Government to negotiate with the UK Government about how that will split will happen with the pot of money that's there from ECO initially. And then how that pot of money gets applied in Scotland. But that pot of money in the first instance is key. And we would argue that there are key drivers in Scotland that would justify the amount of money that we get at the moment, to do with climate and rurality particularly, that demands the bigger investment to tackle the same issue. So I think that has to be made forcibly again, but that's a negotiating position with the...
Could I just say that the spectrum of opportunity is wider than just ECO, because there's a range of funds that I'm not saying we would use any differently, but all I'm saying is the chance for us in Scotland to see the deployment of those funds as being satisfactory to how we see getting best value for our problems and our situations is what I believe would be the right outcome from that Smith devolvement of the energy efficiency obligations.
And what do you think about the consent that is required to be obtained from the Secretary of State?
I thought there'd already been some discussion of that, about not being unreasonably withheld.
Okay. I think one of the things I would caution is this assumes that there will be a continuation of ECO. And by no means is that certain. I know there's a lot of lobbying to Westminster that by taking away the energy company obligation, you will reduce the bills of people by 20, 30, 50 pounds. That in itself is true, but if you remove that burden from the bills, you also remove the opportunity for financial assistance to the people who need it most. So our view is ECO should continue, and I think that's something that we need to establish first. And if it is to continue, then I think the Scottish Government do have the opportunity to shape how it is. And one of the things I would suggest that perhaps you consider is if we can move away from the carbon saving being the main driver, then it does give us greater opportunity. Scotland produces, or Orkney produced, I think, 103 or 104% of its total energy demand from renewable sources. Scotland's target for producing the electricity from the renewable sources is very large. The question I've got in terms of saving carbon, how many lofts would we need to insulate to save the carbon that something like Whiteley's would save as a new energy generator? So we're already well ahead in terms of saving carbon from our generation. We don't need to be fixated on saving carbon from, you know, small minor jobs. I think as Stuart Wilson had highlighted earlier, it is about the quality of life, increasing the energy efficiency of people's homes, not necessarily saving a huge amount of carbon. There will be carbon saving, and I think that's the negotiation that we need to have, that it's not solely focused. We've already seen the energy company obligations streamed into various areas, and forgive me, I've not got all of the acronyms, but HECRO and CERO and a variety of other things that are not necessarily all focused solely on carbon. we've already created that precedent. I think Scotland can create the precedent that it's about achieving better energy efficiency and not carbon saving. And apologies to the reporters for the acronyms.
I think you're getting a visit at the end of the session with a long list of acronyms to explain. Okay, thank you. John Lamont.
Thanks very much. Can I just maybe just a couple of brief points on the budget? We've heard that there's your instinct to invest in things that you get an easy hit from. Is the solution from that, from the Scottish Government's point of view, in budgeting terms, in your view, to ring fence within what is defined as a fuel poverty budget, both in terms of targeting groups but also in terms of the rural urban split?
I think we've seen the HEAPS ABS budget being spread across local authorities, and a percentage of that budget is then held back. I think it's around 30% for local authorities to bid against. And rural local authorities actually do very well in that, because they're able to demonstrate their ability to tackle fuel poor households, to address fuel poverty, to increase energy efficiency. So while we're spreading that money out, while it's not specifically ring-fenced for rural local authorities, I know they punch above their weight in terms of getting that money in. I think you might have a difficult conversation with COSLA if you are looking to ring-fence particular parts of the budget, simply because an area is a rural area. I think if it was ring-fenced on levels of fuel poverty, then we could do something within the overall budget, but I wouldn't say it should be spread across the whole budget.
And do you think it should be ring-fenced, or there should be a division between measures to address fuel poverty and measures to address extreme fuel poverty, because that the spike in extreme fuel poverty figures must be a concern?
I think when we look at what we're doing just now is an area-based approach, and local authorities will take an area, and while, you know, 3 out of 10 houses that they address may not actually live in fuel poverty, the fact that they're preventing the house from getting into fuel poverty, or that household may be in fuel poverty next week, or the largest percentage of people within that area are living in fuel poverty, a lot of them are addressing it in that way just now. So I think it's back to, is the area approach right? Yes, it is. Are we addressing the worst areas where there's the highest percentage of fuel poverty? Yes, we are. And are we supporting people who may not be fuel poor, but who might be on the edges of being fuel poor? And the answer to that, again, is probably yes. So we've probably got that just about right. And I think it's down to local authorities to bring forward, based upon their own local knowledge, the areas that they want to put that investment into. And indeed, when they submit plans for funding to officials, that's the area that they've got to demonstrate. So we're already moving in that direction, and it may well be helpful in future in terms of reporting around the impact of those programmes for that type of thing to be drawn out and reported to this committee, that I'm sure would wish to see just how wisely the money's been spent.
Point about that. In terms of the HEAPS programmes in the rural areas, clearly the rural areas made some lobbying to the government about trying to up the kind of contributions because of the disparity in cost when you get into the rural areas. The one thing I would say about that is, I mean, that was welcome and it did help. However, when you come back to the energy efficiency of the home, you want to try and do the whole house approach rather than bits and bits and have to go back 2 years later to do another bit and another bit. And so the idea is to try and get the whole house approach and at the first visit, when you first go there and deliver that whole house in terms of energy efficiency. So for our stock, that means something like either internal wall or external wall coupled with room in the roof type insulation, where you're doing the whole envelope. And at that point, the transformation in the people's lives is enormous. And if we can then maybe recognise that within the HEAPS budget, and at the moment that's set at £9,000, the contribution, which seems high, but when you come to combined measures that might cost £20,000, then or even higher in some instances, then perhaps a slight movement in that would make a would be a significant difference to be able to do that whole house approach, which is which we were kind of struggle to do at the moment.
Could I just also bring us back to the fourth issue that I think has come out very strongly in the whole of the discussion this morning about where advice and intermediaries that are trusted will help solve the fuel poverty problem, because the issue about budgeting for that is that it's a joining up issue. It's primary care, it's social care, it's the fuel poverty, the technical resource. And I actually think that if that, because let's face it, the best bang for anybody's buck is to go into a home and advise someone that they can actually save money by stopping doing things or using their energy differently. That's the and those sort of, you've heard that it's they're not fuel poverty people that do that, they're intermediaries who are in the home and with those people all the time. But how you budget for that, I don't see it necessarily being a fuel poverty allocation. It has to come in other parts of the budget that then join up to help address the problem.
I was just going to ask about that. We've got three groups who are involved in fuel poverty, but actually a lot of what's been talked about today is people who are living in poverty, who then some of them will fall into fuel poverty category. For example, in Glasgow, because of stock transfer, if you're in a socially rented house, you're more likely to be in an energy efficient house than if you're in a private rent sector or own an ex-council house. What work is done at government level to bring you in to the government's anti-poverty strategy? So that you're dealing, you're not looking at somebody saying their house is cold, you're looking at somebody who's poor and part of it is their house is cold, but they're also more likely to be ill. So are you linked in to the development of the Scottish Government's anti-poverty strategy and budget decisions that come from that? So we invest in addressing poverty by investing in intermediaries in the voluntary sector, whatever, who do fuel poverty advice, but they may do other advice too.
I think that happens at a number of levels, and certainly the Fuel Poverty Forum as a single unit before it recently was given these new duties, has been looking, and particularly with primary health care, we've got some very interested and active people now in the forum that are working on the health and social care front, and these are people that are well known to people like Heather and others who in the local authorities are actually delivering on the ground. So it's starting to emerge. I just think we need to do a lot more.
Track, for example, of voluntary sector organisations, the funding for that in the budget is reducing. That might have an impact on the capacity to deliver advice around fuel poverty.
It may well, and it's why that mapping that I mentioned, which certainly Mr Neil is aware of, and because I passed it to him, I think it's that sort of thing that will identify strategically where the joints should be, but the reality has to come on the ground, and all that has to join up.
I think at policy level, the health and social care integration agenda and these new bodies that have been effectively been set up to drive that forward can be key in that as well, and linking in there and again using services that are already on the ground rather than reinventing the wheel, where you've got services that are on the ground delivering in people's homes, the most vulnerable, probably all the people who are fuel poor. It's trying to identify them within that policy and then putting drivers there for those policymakers to build them into their strategies, which they're doing right at this point in time. So, but you know, people like the care and repair services throughout Scotland that are there are kind of ideal placed to run that type of thing. So it's trying to get them built into those strategies that are already getting put in place.
One of the things that's happening in Glasgow, and it's starting in Glasgow, but hopefully will be rolled out, is a programme called the Links Workers Project, where a number of doctor surgeries have benefit advisors within the surgery. So if the doctor, and it spawned out of a very good report called GPs at the Deep End, and those deprived communities, the doctor has access to a benefits advisor. The doctor won't prescribe, or in terms of seeing someone who they believe would benefit from that. additional advice and support, we'll refer on to a colleague. So you go for your doctor's appointment, but you also see someone who can support you in a wide variety of things. And it's that type of joined up approach that we're actually starting to see. As Stuart said, what we do need to do is find out how well that's worked, and if it has worked, then build that into the health and social care budget, not just as a fuel poverty alleviation, but very much around preventative medicine and good health care.
Going to say, for the life of me, I can't remember the acronym for this hub that exists in Dundee, but it's all the voluntary agencies come together on a site and the cross refer, so they're all aware of what each other do, what specific aspect of poverty that they're specialists in, and as I say, the cross refer, and it doesn't cost anything really, and it develops itself over time, that one contact leads to another.
Thank you.
Gordon McDonald.
Thanks very much, convener, and my apologies for missing the start of the meeting. I just wanted to ask you two very quick questions. I don't know if the answers will be quick, but we're in a situation where the Scottish Government's fuel poverty budget has doubled since 2008, yet we've seen the proportion of people in fuel poverty increasing. So, you know, necessarily throwing money at it isn't going to be the right answer. So my question is, we've talked about the four factors that influence fuel poverty, which is fuel price, which is household income, energy efficiency and energy usage. What is the number one key factor in driving energy fuel poverty? And secondly, DEC released figures fairly recently of a comparison across Europe, which highlighted that pre-tax electricity prices were the highest in Europe and Britain, and gas was amongst the highest in Britain. What's driving that, and is there anything that can be done either at UK or Scottish Government level to address that problem?
If I start and say it's got to be fabric first. Had the Scottish Government not put money into its energy efficiency programmes, fuel poverty would have been significantly higher. So we know that approach works. If theoretically your fuel bill is £2,000 and you have a 20% increase, that's quite a lot to take. If your fuel bill is £300 and you get a 20% increase, that's less of a hit. And I think it's what we've got to do is ensure that all homes are made as energy efficient as possible. It does two things. It future-proofs you against the shocks of big rises, but also contributes to climate change. So fabric first has got to be a good way of doing that. Not much point in putting a heating system into somebody's house if the fabric leaks. And we've seen some stuff in Orkney where you can actually put your hands around the outside door because the frame is just hanging on. New heating system in a house like that, the heat's just coming out. So fabric first works. We know that because had the Scottish Government not continued to fund these programmes, fuel poverty would have been much higher. In terms of energy prices, energy prices are high. We import a lot of our energy now that we didn't do before. So again, fabric first, reduce the demand for importing energy will help. But one of the things that the Competition Markets Authority looked at was the wholesale market. If you think of the cost of your gas or electricity, almost 50% of that cost is the wholesale cost of gas or electricity. I think you need to look at other markets to see if that's a comparable cost. And my suggestion would be that market doesn't work for British consumers. We've got a wholesale cost that's exceptionally high, and that continues to push our prices up. 50% of your bill on the wholesale cost, and there's not much that I can, you as a customer, can do about that 50%. You can move your supplier, but your supplier's still buying from the same pool. So CMA will be reporting later, potentially not this year, but in the spring of next year, and I would hope that they would have something to say about the wholesale market. Okay.
All right. Anything else? Sixworth, do you want to add anything?
No.
Oh, God. Okay. Briefly,
I totally agree. Fabric first, most sensible approach. Transparency in bills that we talked about earlier helps people switch. And at the moment, you think of some of the distribution costs that are on bills, they're weighted towards rural Scotland. We would argue for a fairer spread of that. And local delivery chains went for these for the delivery of these schemes, because that keeps money in the local area, which helps alleviate fuel poverty. So it's about trying to get local supply chains.
Heather?
Yeah, in simplistic terms, we're throwing money at fuel poverty measures. Fuel poverty is going up. Why did we bother? What I would say is in Dundee in the last year, we've externally insulated about 800 houses, and we'll hopefully continue to do that. Stuart said eco's horrible. I would say heaps is fantastic. We've got whole estates that are transformed, they're regenerated because of the outward appearance, which isn't strictly anything to do with energy efficiency, but that's the added value. And we've got people who, if they're not out of fuel poverty, they're certainly warmer for the same amount of money. And we're able to do other works while scaffolding's up for the EWI, which has economies. We've got local labour, so there's win-win-win there, and I'm not dissing heaps for a minute.
Okay, right. Thank you all. We have run considerably over time, but I think that just indicates the committee's interest in the subject. It's been a very useful session, and we appreciate you all coming along and helping us. We will now have a brief suspension to allow a changeover. Thank you. Okay, if we can reconvene, we're now on item 5 on the agenda, and a slight change of topic. We're back to our inquiry onto work, wages and well-being in the Scottish labour market. And I'd like to welcome to give us evidence this morning a familiar face for many of us, Karen Whitefield, who is campaigns officer at USDA, the Shop Workers Union. Welcome. I think we're going to run this probably for about 45 minutes, I think. And if I could remind members if they would keep their questions short and to the point, and answers as short and to the point would be helpful in getting through the topics we want to discuss in the time available. I wonder if I can maybe just start off and ask you about the work of the Fair Work Convention that's been established by the Scottish Government. And I wonder if you could tell us, from your perspective, from the union's perspective, what would you like to see be the outcome from that? What would you like to see in the framework, and how do you see the role of that convention developing?
We welcome the establishment of the Fair Work initiative by the Scottish Government. We would like to see good engagement with all trade unions, but particularly for the Scottish Government to recognise the difference between those trade unions that operate in the public sector and for those of us who operate entirely in the private sector, because there are different challenges there. And I recognise that the Scottish Government have invited a number of trade union representatives to sit on their panel. Many of them, though, come from a public sector background, and I would just ask that we get an opportunity to make representations. We would want them to say something in their findings about pay, but we would want them to remember that rates of pay is not the only issue to tackling poverty, and particularly in-work poverty. You will have seen in the media there's been lots of discussion about some retailers paying the living wage, and whilst we would welcome that, if you are on a short-term contract or only have a 6 hours contract, whether your employer is paying you the living wage or not is not going to address whether or not you're living in poverty and working. So we would want them to address some of those issues, and remember it's not just simply about pay, to look at the wider terms and conditions, and also to be setting an example about the importance of trade unions and the valuable role they can play in the workplace to ensuring that there's good industrial relations. They're not a threat, they're not there to intimidate, they're there to work in a spirit of partnership.
I mean, just as you're talking about pay, I mean, do you have a sense across the retail sector, in very rough terms, what sort of percentages of employees would be paid more or less than the living wage?
Well, for example, we know right now that there are 1.5 million people who are currently being paid a higher rate of pay than the national minimum wage, as it's just been increased in October, but for whom will receive no benefit for the increase that the government are going to make to the national living wages introduced next year. So those are people who are being paid more than the £7.20 right now rate, but are not being paid what we would consider to be the national living wage that's been argued for by the Living Wage Foundation. So there's 1.5 million of those people, for example.
1 million altogether, 1.5 million in the retail industry?
No, it's 1.5 million altogether.
Altogether, okay. And do you know how many are in the retail industry?
No.
Okay, thanks. I'll bring in Gordon MacDonald.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Convener. Just on that topic of living wage, we've obviously had announcements recently from one discounter and another supermarket chain that they're going to start to pay the living wage. And I had discussions recently with one of the other large supermarket chains who said that they would quite happily introduce the living wage, but what effect that would have would be that they would no longer pay breaks, they would no longer pay bonuses to their staff, and the staff discounts that they give for in-store purchases would be removed as well. In terms of your members, what is better, that they paid the living wage or they get these other perks? I mean, how do you balance that? Or, I mean, it would be great to get everything, but, you know, what's the preference in terms of your membership?
I think probably as a trade unionist, it comes as no surprise to you that I would say that we would want both, and we would argue for both. But we're also realistic, and I think you do need a combination of both. Fundamentally, we will always argue and campaign for greater basic rates of pay for our members. That's why we exist. It's what we do. It's one of the main reasons that we're there to support our members. But if we are serious about tackling in-work poverty, it isn't simply about the rate of pay. It is about your terms and conditions. It is about those breaks. It is about paid holidays. It's about sick pay when you're ill or you're injured at work. It's about what help you get if you're the victim of a violent crime, simply for doing your job. Those discounts that our members, interestingly, you might be surprised to learn that we surveyed our members and USDAW regularly communicate with our members to make sure that we know what is important to them. And the majority of them said that they would be very concerned if they were to lose the discount schemes that they benefit from their employer, because it does make a difference to them, and it's something that they value and they would want to hold on to. And, you know, I regularly, when I'm out and about, see the placard saying that some retailers who don't recognise trade unions are proud to be the first retailer to pay the living wage. How many staff do they have in those stores? What kind of contracts are those individuals on? Do they get a phone call in the morning just being told that they're needed today, but they might not know if they're going to be needed tomorrow? There are real difficulties there for people about managing their family incomes and being able to live and survive.
I mean, I support the fact that we need to roll out the living wage to the retail sector, but one of the pressures that I've heard from independent convenience store owners in my constituency is that they cannot afford to pay the living wage because they're under pressure from the multiples who are also moving into the convenience store market. So, you know, what do we need to do in order to convince the independent sector that it is important that the living wage is paid?
Sometimes we forget that we've not always even had a national minimum wage in this country, and USDAW was instrumental in arguing for the creation of the national minimum wage. And many of you will remember that at the time when we were making those arguments, that people said that a national minimum wage would be disastrous for the retail sector, that people couldn't afford to pay it, and there would be grave difficulties, people would lose their jobs. The reality is that when the national minimum wage was introduced, that doomsday didn't happen. So I think it's about being realistic. There's no doubt that things are highly competitive in retail today, but I think the suggestion that retailers couldn't afford to pay the national living wage is often a little bit pessimistic, given that the economy is showing signs of improvement, and we have had 29 months of consecutive month-on-month growth in retail sales across the United Kingdom.
And you've said that the economy is growing. I mean, by paying the living wage, I mean it will increase the spend in people's pockets, which will have a knock-on effect on spend in stores and supermarkets. So, you know, why do you think that message hasn't got through to the supermarket chains or the convenience store sector?
Particularly in the convenience store, things in retail are changing, and there is lots of the large retailers, particularly in food, the big four, the Tesco's, the Morrison's and the cooperatives of this world, are changing their focus. You probably have noticed that across the country there are very few new large store openings. They're moving into the convenience sector market, and that is about competition, and those larger companies have the advantages of an economy of scale, of purchasing goods for their large stores and their smaller stores in a way that some of the small independents don't have. But and that's why they have to, you know, we do work with the Association of Convenience Stores on all sorts of issues, and you know, they're working with their members to support them and to deal with some of those challenges.
Okay, thanks. John Lamont.
Thanks very much. One of the focuses of the inquiry is the impact of poor quality work on the economy and obviously on people's individual health and the likelihood of whether they're working or not. I wonder if you, from your written evidence, which I think was very useful, I wonder if you want to expand a bit on a couple of issues. First of all, in the question of 0 hours, I was very struck by the evidence which talked about increased flexibility from the employer, so that because 0 hours contracts are sold on the basis it's benefit to everybody because you've got flexibility, but you were describing circumstance where people are expected to basically be available for long swathes of time, even though they've only got a very short contract. Can you describe that, but also say, is there any evidence that those kinds of contracts mean that people are falling out of employment, they're having to stop working, and what are the consequences then?
Retail was a sector that historically people entered because it was seen as being family friendly, and they could manage working around family commitments or caring commitments, and that is by and large still an incentive for many people who work in retail to stay there. But increasingly the nature of retail and the competitiveness of the market has introduced changes. There's always been flexibility, but we now have a culture of 24/7 shopping, and retailers trying to cut their margins by ensuring that they only have staff in store when they absolutely need them, when they know that they're going to be at their busiest. Many of the large retailers are now using electronic scheduling, which maps out when the store is likely to be at its busiest, but that's based on what's happened the previous week. So now employees don't know any more than often a week in advance when they're required to work. And that gives individuals a difficulty in trying to be able to plan to pick up their children from school, or if they've got an elderly relative that they look after or a next door neighbour that they keep an eye on, that gives them difficulties. And there is an issue, the flexibility is becoming a little bit, in our opinion as a union, too much tilted towards the what suits the employer rather than the individual. I think all of our members would accept the need to be flexible, but many of them are being asked to be flexible within a growing window of time. So they may well have a 16-hour contract or a 20-hour contract a week, and be hoping that they're going to work those hours during the school day or in the evenings. But all of a sudden they're learning that they've got to be available between 6 a.m. and midnight, and they could be asked at any point in the next week to work at any time in those time frames, and that makes life difficult for people. The committee specifically asked us about experiences, and you'll see that there's a case study about a woman called Sandra. Now Sandra consented to me being able to talk to the committee about her experience. Sandra has worked in retail. She's 52. She's worked in retail since she left school, and she worked for a large retailer who had a store closure last October. She had one of those contracts where she worked full-time hours, and she generally worked during the day. She cares for her elderly mother who's in her 80s. She was unemployed for a couple of months and got another job with another retailer. But the flexibility, she's desperate to work. She wants to work. She can't afford not to work. But the flexibility being demanded by that employer has given her difficulties, because she wasn't required to make herself available from 6 a.m. to midnight. She needs to give her mother her medication and put her to bed. After 6 weeks of trying this, her mother's health was deteriorating. She'd asked her employer if she could be flexible from 6 a.m. to 9 p.m. The the manager said, well, I can't give you special treatment, and we do need to recognise that there's massive pressures on managers in retail to manage the schedules. And she's been forced to give up that job because she just couldn't balance caring for her mum and the job. Now, she's waiting to hear if she's going to be sanctioned because she voluntarily gave up that job. She didn't want to stop working. She wants to work. But that's the dilemma for somebody in that position.
So you end up in a position where somebody who's qualified to do the job falls out of work. And I think it might be something we want to go back and look at, because we did raise with DWP whether they were sanctioning people on the basis of an unreasonable demand in their work. And it would be useful to know that kind of experience of having to be available between 6 in the morning and midnight, how prevalent that now is in the sector. Are there circumstances where employers in retail actually recognise that and will almost ring-fence the bit of time that you don't have to be flexible? Are there good examples of good practice in that regard?
Certainly, with the employers we work with, they all have partnership agreements with us, which gives us an opportunity to raise with them changing core hours. But it used to be the case that often employers wouldn't expect their employees to change their hours any more than once a year. We are finding that increasingly they're expecting their employees to consult with the trade union on changing their hours much more regularly, often 2-3 times a year, and there's growing uncertainty, and there's also growing pressure on managers to manage those schedules, and that's a concern for us as a union as well, because those managers are our members as well, and we've got a duty of care to them to protect them. So there needs to be a recognition that that employers must have good work-life balance role models, particularly in their management teams, and that's not always there at the moment.
Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. It's afternoon, actually. Retail is extremely important for some of our rural communities as well, in terms of sustainability of our rural communities. And we know it from your submission, obviously, the flexibility that perhaps maybe isn't maybe quite as available now as was maybe a few years ago. Within the rural areas, there's a lot of people working part-time, and they're very small shops in some respects, you know, sometimes 1, 2, 3 employees. What's your relationship with the FSB in trying to ensure that sustainability is there, but obviously people working in the industry have a good deal in terms of their wage and their flexibility, and indeed we relate that to a person's well-being and the overall well-being of that community?
I think it's important to note that in retail, 60% of retail employees in Scotland actually are part-time, and that's higher than the rest of the United Kingdom, and I think that possibly is for the some of the reasons that you've suggested, Mr. Robertson, about the nature of Scotland just being slightly different from the rest of the United Kingdom, and having more rural communities with smaller towns and villages and smaller shops. I'm not aware of us having a great deal of contact with the Federation of Small Business. We tend to organise in the larger organisations and multinational companies that operate across the United Kingdom, and our connections tend to be with the British Retail Consortium and the Scottish Retail Consortium, who I am sure do have discussions regularly with the FSB. We also speak regularly to the Association of Convenience Stores, who support small convenience stores across the country, and in fact we're heavily involved with ACS right now in our Keep Sunday Special campaign, which predominantly is about England and Wales, but I'll just say that it does affect Scotland, because Scottish shop workers get a Sunday premium, which may be at risk if Sunday trading becomes just like any other day across the rest of the UK.
Okay. Are you aware of, you know, sort of union membership within the sort of rural communities within Scotland, some You know, we're talking some of our towns and villages. Is there a high membership or is it a fairly significant low membership within the unions?
No, we have membership in every part of the country and in our rural communities and our island communities as well. It does vary from constituency to constituency, as you would expect. There's higher density in some parts of Scotland than others, but that's possibly because there's higher density of retail facilities in some parts of Scotland than there are in others. Certainly, Usdaw doesn't see any community as a no-go one. We would want all retail employees to take advantage of being a member of a trade union because there are distinct benefits from being part of a trade union.
Yeah, and lastly, convener, it's just about the flexibility of contracts, and you've mentioned that I think 60% of people have probably worked part-time. And that maybe is to manage the caring facilities and, that you've mentioned as well. Do you see an advantage of people going into a more permanent contracts rather than just the sort of flexibility in having sort of stated hours? Or is the flexibility something that you would continue to support in terms of individual workers and in terms of their specific needs?
I think we need to recognise that there has to be flexibility for the employer, but there also has to be flexibility for the employee. Where we need to be careful is that we don't arrive at a situation where there's no certainty about hours worked. And that's increasingly what's changing in retail. That people may well have. It's not about necessarily always wanting to work part-time. It's about having no choice. There are no additional hours there. You might be willing to work full-time, but they're not on offer. Increasingly, employers are, instead of offering full-time contracts, offer short hours contracts rather than part-time contracts, short hour contracts, and then they ask their employees to pay to work extra hours, and there are difficulties with that for the employee because there's no certainty of or guarantee of income, so they may well work regularly 30 hours a week, but they don't in actual fact know from week to week how many hours they're going to work, so they don't therefore know how much money they've got. That gives them difficulties in securing a loan to buy a new car, whether it's to get their first foot in the the mortgage ladder and buy a house, which we think should be the aspiration of all workers if that's what they choose to do. And there are difficulties there if you've got a short hour contract but regularly working full-time hours, and we would argue that that's an issue that government does have an obligation to address around contractual hours, and that's why we're against zero-hour contracts, and we also argue that short-hour contracts are as pernicious as zero-hour contracts.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Joan McAlpin.
Thank you very much. Our evidence for this inquiry has shown that, you know, trade union membership and societies that have got high levels of trade union membership have better paying conditions for the workers, which would seem self-evident, but I think it's quite interesting because it's as important as setting a living wage in some countries. And in your written evidence, you talk about organising and the difficulty of recruiting, and you say that you've got to recruit in Scotland 9,000 new members every year just to kind of stand still. What are the barriers to recruiting in your sector, and how could you organise more effectively?
This is membership week for us. We have a number of membership weeks. So across the country as we speak, we have our full-time officials and our organising officers and our reps in stores selling the advantages of being a member of a trade union, and particularly Usdaw. And you're right, we do have to recruit 9,000 members annually in Scotland alone just to stand still, 70,000 members across the whole of the United Kingdom. But despite that, we're the fastest growing union in the TUC, and we've grown our membership by 17% in the last five years, which I think is a pretty remarkable achievement. There are barriers. Low pay is undoubtedly an issue. If you're struggling to make ends meet, even although our membership rates are pretty competitive, just having to pay £9 a month is a bit of, you know, is money that you think, well, actually, I could do something else with that. Short hour contracts, again, if people think they're not going to be there for very long, they might think, well, what's the point of joining? I only plan to be here for a certain amount of time. And I think that is, there are more and more people moving into retail who perhaps never saw that as their permanent career path. They were doing something else before they were made redundant and have moved into retail, so they and they might think they're not going to stay there, so they're not ready to join the trade union because they think they're moving on somewhere else. That turns out not often to be the case after 5 or 6 years, so it's our responsibility to encourage them to join the union whilst they're there. And I think one of the reasons that we have successfully grown our membership is because we have invested in training our network of volunteer reps in store and in taking our volunteer reps out of store and bringing them to work for the union for six months. We have a training academy which is all about organising and equipping our reps and preparing them for roles of leadership in the union, something which I think the Scottish Government have recognised is important, and I think there is a lot there to learn from us though about how we recognise and value and support our reps through training. And for that reason, it's quite often the case that we spend and invest in our reps and they get accredited national accreditation for the skills and qualifications that they leave the academy with, and some of them don't always go on to work for us. Other unions pinch them because they're so well trained and they see the value that we've invested in them.
But in terms of the good work that you're doing, how's that going to be affected by the UK Trade Union Bill?
There's no doubt that the Trade Union Bill is of great concern to all of us who value good industrial relations. There are lots of things that we could all list that are wrong with the Trade Union Bill. It seems to me that there's a great deal of focus on strike action when USDAW members regularly go to work. I'm not aware of us having too many retail strikes in living memory. And so I was slightly concerned about the focus and this desire that the government have to stop strike action in some industries, and they seem to want to take a sledgehammer to industrial relations across all sectors as a consequence of that. But I think primarily for me there are two things that the Trade Union Bill will damage. They'll damage industrial good industrial relations because they will it will mean that the partnership agreements that we currently have with our employers who are willing to talk to us before they take big decisions about changes to terms and conditions and engage with us at an early stage before they go to talk to the membership so that we can ameliorate perhaps the effects of that. They'll be under no obligation to do that any longer. And in fact, it might well become that it's just no longer considered to even be good practice to do that stuff. So I think good industrial relations will be undermined and the workers will suffer as a result of that. It also seeks to prevent our members from having a political voice. And being a member of a trade union is not just about wages and conditions and the industrial bargaining. That's important and it's our core business, but it's also about a political voice as well. And that's not about any party political persuasion of the government. It's about sometimes we need to lobby on issues which affect our members. Now, there are many members here across all parties who have supported USDAW's Freedom From Fear campaign, which seeks to tackle violence to shop workers. I fear that the trade union bill will prevent us in the future having the ability to campaign effectively for political change, and we will work with employers to ameliorate the effect of violence in store, but sometimes it requires political change, and it's the right of a trade union to make those arguments, and the trade union bill, I fear, risks damaging that ability to do that kind of campaigning work.
Okay, thanks very much.
Okay, I think Chick Brody wants to come in with a follow-up.
Following up, good afternoon, by the way. Following up Joan McAlpine's initial question, you deal largely with large retailers, which is a shame because, you know, clearly we need to look after those that work in smaller businesses. But tell me, what are the benefits of union membership compared to other forms of collective bargaining and engagement, such as in John Lewis, for example? Why is John Lewis so successful?
There are lots of companies that are successful, but so are the some of the retailers that we work with. We would argue that there are distinct benefits from being a member of a trade union. It's not just about your pay and conditions.
Why is John Lewis so successful, and what benefits do you bring to the other large retailers?
Well, I heard Joanne saying it's a cooperative, and that may well be the one of the advantages, something that makes John Lewis's different from other retailers. It sees its staff as partners, not necessarily as employees, because they're working it together. Although I would point out that sometimes we talk about John Lewis's, but as a great success story, and I'm not about to damage them, but there are other retailers that we work with who pay much higher rates of pay than John Lewis's, and perhaps that's because they recognise us, though, that's the case. But I think there are additional issues and additional benefits from trade union membership other than pay, and it's about access to legal services. It's about support if you have an accident at work. It's about death benefits. It's about maternity grants. Those are all benefits that you get from being a member of a trade union, in addition to any other worker.
And I support equity participation, cooperatives, you know, collective bargaining, save employees and how they operation. So you still haven't answered the question, why are John Lewis so successful compared to some of the other retailers where there is union membership?
Well, it's not really for me to justify the success or otherwise of John Lewis. I would probably surprise you to learn that we do have a number of members who work for John Lewis and the Waitrose organisation. Those members obviously choose to join us, even although we don't have a recognition agreement with the company, because they think that there are additional benefits to being a member of a trade union. And that comes back to the point that if they were to be sacked and need the services of an industrial tribunal right now, if the trade union would be in a position to assist them with that. And they also have a right to access our accident helpline. So obviously, despite the successes of the John Lewis partnership, there are some members of their staff still think there's a benefit to being in the trade union.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. Returning briefly to the actual subject of the inquiry, you talked a little bit about the living wage, the minimum wage, and the UK government's new policy of introducing what it calls a national living wage, an upper band for workers aged 25 and over on the minimum wage. And you also talked about flexibility and the way that can often be abusive or manipulative. I'd like to talk about the connection between those two themes. I've heard anecdotally people working in particularly larger retailers who find that as they get older and as their minimum wage increases, because they're no longer on the under 21 or the under 18 band, they find that they get fewer hours, or they get given hours that the employer knows won't work for them, that they're not going to be able to take, or other ways of kind of easing people out or freezing people out. Is that something you recognise, and do you anticipate it increasing, becoming a bigger problem as the gap between those age bands increases when this 25-year age band is introduced?
I think you're right to identify that there's a problem there. USDA have long campaigned against there being any age discrimination in terms of rates of pay. You're doing the job whether you're 17, 18, or 25, or 30, 35. And we are concerned about the new national living wages proposed by the government and its distinction between those workers who are under 25 and over 25. And the retailers that we work with, generally as part of our partnership agreements, we have eradicated differentials in rates of pay for based on age. And I think that's a benefit of the trade union. That's why we're there. It's to argue against it. But we do believe the proposals that the government have brought forward are inherently unfair and wrong, and we'll be campaigning against them because they will discriminate against individuals. And we do fear that increasingly employers will look to save money, to cut costs by employing younger people, and making sure that they're never on a permanent contract, so that they can get rid of them when they get to the top end of the age scale, and that is a real concern for us.
So once the gap between the youngest and the oldest age bands is kind of perhaps £5 an hour, that could be the gap we could be talking about. The incentive for employers to do that will be much greater than it is at present.
Absolutely. Okay. And retail is very incredibly competitive. Retailers are always looking to cut their costs, and if you give them that opportunity, then they'll use it.
I think I've heard some of them openly arguing that that's what they're going to do, is try and find ways to claw this money back from their employees once the so-called national
living
wage comes in.
It's also one of the ways that employers get out of paying premiums as well, that are part of contracts, so that increasingly they'll take on new staff. It's not about age, and it's about taking on staff who to work in bank holidays or on Sundays or for holiday periods, so that they don't need to pay them time and a half. And that's a concern, because it undermines the collective agreement that there should be premium pay for certain times of working on certain occasions.
Just one last point, which is about this phrase that we've heard from the Scottish Government about exploitative zero-hours contracts. And there's been some discussion at committee about what that means, how we can pin it down. And the convener put that question to the First Minister at the conveners group just recently. The First Minister said, examples of when a zero-hours contract becomes exploitative is when employers deny workers regular or sufficient working hours, or unfairly penalise workers for being unavailable for work or not accepting offers of work. Is that enough of a definition, or does the exploitative use of zero-hours contract and other forms of contract go beyond just those practices? You mentioned short notice, for example, short notice periods about when someone's going to be offered hours.
Yeah, I think the definition that the First Minister used is one that we could sign up to, and we don't have any difficulty with that. But we would like it to go slightly further, because we would like it to recognise the difficulties that are caused by short-term contracts, short-hours contracts, and also the issues around flexibility. Those two things are different, but they can cause equal difficulties for the employee.
Thank you. Louise McDonald.
Thank you very much. I'm like Patrick, keen to focus in on issues that affect the incomes of people and the security that people have, and clearly one of the issues much talked about this week has been tax credits. What, in your assessment, what difference does the availability of tax credits make to members of USDA, to people working in retail? What would the impact be of the abolition that has been proposed? And what difference will a three-year delay in implementation of that make to members, in your view?
Well, I'm sure it'll probably come as no surprise to you to know that USDA was delighted by the decision of the House of Lords, and we lobbied members of the House of Commons and the House of Lords very hard on this issue. Tax credits are very important to the majority of our members. And I think sometimes politicians become obsessed by talking about the living wage and rates of pay, and believing that if you pay the living wage, then we'll eradicate poverty. The reality is that many of the people who would have been affected by the tax credit cuts are already being paid more than the figure that's proposed to be the national living wage, yet they're still struggling to get by. Some of that's about the hours they work, but some of them, and actually many of them, are working full-time hours. So when it's suggested that they find extra hours, it's not really that simple. There's a case study in our written evidence about Mark and Agnes, both USDA members who live in Port Glasgow. Some of you actually might, as well as having read the evidence, you might have seen Mark. He was on the front of the Daily Record a few weeks ago, in advance of the tax credit decision being taken in the House of Commons. And Mark and Agnes work between them 60 hours a week. Mark's a delivery driver with a large retailer. His wife works as a checkout operator. They're not work shy, they're not lazy, they're going out to work every single day. But the reality is that for them, life is increasingly difficult. The cost of living has increased, and their income hasn't, and they're going to lose £2,100 if the tax credit changes as proposed go ahead. So if they don't go ahead and the government honour the decision taken in the House of Commons, that will most certainly give them and families like them a real respite and a bit of assistance in the short term. But we need to address the wider issue of in-work poverty, and it isn't simply about rates of pay. And that's why tax credits are so valuable.
Absolutely. And I was particularly struck when you said that a majority of your members would be covered by this. I mean, and a couple for whom £2,000 would presumably be a significant share, or £2,100 would be a significant share of their income. So really, is what you're telling us that people who at the moment are faced with financial challenges but are getting by will in these circumstances really find it much harder to get by?
Absolutely will. And whilst the IFS have pointed out that there are 3 million working families going to be affected by the tax credit changes as proposed by the government, there needs to be a recognition that in actual fact 1.5 million of those families will have no ability to be able to improve the outcomes and change their circumstances, because they're people that are not going to benefit from any increase to the national minimum wage as proposed by the government, because they're already being paid. And so the government makes changes to the basic rate of pay next year, but it doesn't affect them because they're already being paid in excess of that rate of pay. But at the same time, they're going to lose their tax credits. But and on top of that, the clawback, so it's not just about taking away tax credits, the clawback to the tax credit is also going to increase, so that for every additional hour they work, if they're able to secure additional hours, for every pound they earn, the tax man is going to take 97 pence of that pound back from them in clawback. How does that make any sense? It doesn't, and that's why it needs to be recognised that in the House of Lords wasn't just Labour members and Liberal Democrats who spoke out about what was being proposed. It was Conservatives as well who said, wait a minute, let's hold back, let's look at this and let's think about whether or not these changes as they are being proposed to tax credits actually are the right thing to do. And I'm grateful to Lord Lawson and the other Tories who stood up and spoke out and said, let's wait a minute.
Yeah, and you mentioned, I think, and that's very helpful, you mentioned there were wider efforts would be required to tackle in-work poverty. Clearly the tax system and tax credits are part of that. Are there other measures this committee should consider in our recommendations that are specifically around members of yours and other working people in poverty?
I think you want to be mindful that it's about rates of pay, it's about tax credits, it's about terms and conditions, and it is a recognition of the value of those terms and conditions and sometimes the value and benefit of the schemes that some employers, whether they're in retail or in other fields, offer to their employees and the benefits, in-kind benefits that they generate for individuals.
Thank you. I never thought I'd hear the day, Mrs. Whiteflee, you'd be praising Tory peers in the House of Lords. There we go. Richard Lyle.
Fiona, good afternoon, Karen. Can I say I previously was an USDA member. I worked in the grocery trade from 1965 to 1980 as a grocery assistant manager, grocery manager, grocery departmental manager. Grocery has changed in the last 35 years. I used to get a Wednesday off and a Saturday off, never worked a Sunday. Now it's 24/7, as you say. It's basically them. Many of the questions I was going to ask already have been asked. But one of the comments I'm going to make, just in regards to the last comment you made, we talk about an hourly wage. Should we maybe not start now to talk about a national minimum weekly wage? Because even the hourly wage, if you multiply it by 35 hours a week, is under £300 a week, which is not, you know, when you come down to it paying your gas, your electric, your food bill, you've got two kids, you know, we've all been there. At the end of the day, it's not a lot of money. But that wasn't the question I was going to ask you. Are you, just to throw a wobbler, are there any, you spoke about companies, and I have to say, as an USDA member, during the time I was an USDA member, USDA was an excellent union, so you can take that back, and have high praise for you. But is there any companies that are deliberately debarring you from actively recruiting? You maybe will not want to name them, or you may want to name them, are actively debarring you from recruiting members. You spoke about one company who say they're paying the living wage now, but they actually don't let you in to get members, which I found quite interesting a couple of minutes ago.
I have noticed when I reviewed the evidence, Mr. Lyle, that you've long campaigned and raised with all of your witnesses the issue about making sure that people have sufficient income to be able to survive. And I do think that this is an issue that we do need to wrestle with. We do need to try and find a solution to make sure that work pays. That's all our members, at the end of the day, all our members want is to be able to go out to work and for work to pay and to be able to look after their families. And right now, for many of them, that's a struggle, and there isn't an easy solution to it, and it's something that people will need to wrestle with. In relation to employers that don't recognise us, I don't think it's a secret that Lidl and Aldi don't recognise us. That doesn't stop us recruiting. There will have been activities probably. If you passed any Aldi or Lidl across the country, there'll have been USDA members outside of those stores trying to recruit at some point this week. And we do have members in those stores, which is why we are able to know generally what kind of terms and conditions people are working with. We think it's regrettable that those employers don't always recognise a trade union, because I think there are genuine benefits for them as an employer that they would get if they were to recognise us, not just for the employee. we as a trade union will keep on working with all employers to try and get them to recognise us, and you know, and the more members we have within their employees, the more likely it is for them then to recognise us, which is one of the reasons that in recent years we have had pretty high profile campaigns in relation to Aldi, Lidl and Marks and Spencers, I may hasten to add.
Thank you very much, convener.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think we're through our questions. Thank you very much, Ms Wakefield, for coming along to the committee this morning. It has been very helpful. We will now suspend briefly and go into private session.